All right, let's call for the question.
Councilmember Barrera?
Aye.
Councilmember De La Rosa?
What are we voting on the whole?
No, you're on eight. We've already done the other ones.
We're on eight?
We're just doing eight alone.
Yes.
Councilmember Lutz?
Aye.
Councilmember McShane?
Yes.
Councilmember Sanchez?
Yes.
Mayor Donahue?
Yep. Okay. Thank you, everyone. All right, with that, we're going to, because I know we have a lengthy item coming up, we'll go ahead and take a five-minute break, and then we'll get started.
Okay. Excuse me, can we come back? City Council members, Mayor Donahue had to leave, so I will be taking over. So let's get started, please.
Taking over.
Oh. I'm looking for Grace Aston. Oh, it'll be, okay, Grace and
Grace.
Alan.
Yes.
Okay. So we are ready. So it's a public hearing, and we're going to receive the report for the draft for the year 2012 and 13 action plan regarding use of the CDBG home and ESG funds. So we'll receive the report from Alan Stump, planning manager.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. Just wanted to give you a few introductory comments before I turn the presentation over to Grace Aston. And here we go. Wanted to just bring a little bit of context to the program over time and the funding issues that we're facing over time. As you can see from about 10 years ago, the 2003-2004 grant period, we had a CDBG grant amount of a little over $3 million. And if you go down to the bottom of the table, you'll see the current year's grant of $1.878 million. And this is a 40% drop over that 10-year period. This is also reflecting in reduced staffing levels and our reduced ability to provide a lot of things that are not only nice to have in the community, but are essential to have in the community. It includes capital projects, community services, and on the next page here, affordable housing, which has been devastated even to a greater degree, a 50% reduction over a 10-year period, but just in the last year alone, a 41% reduction, which unfortunately, with the elimination of redevelopment dollars this year, as you might recall, 20% of the redevelopment agency's funding would go to affordable housing. We would allocate over $1 million a year in redevelopment housing funds to leverage our local dollars with our affordable housing partners in the community to bring millions more dollars each year to provide affordable housing. Unfortunately, we're down to just a quarter of what those allocations would be in past years. In this context, I do want to commend the housing staff, especially planning manager Grace Aston, who's now been doing this for a couple of years. She's taken over and done a great job in with her staff in meeting the demands of the programs, but also meeting very stringent HUD requirements that seem to keep increasing each year as well. Unfortunately, with these reductions, though, we have even greater challenges this year and in coming years. We have set limits on the administrative charges that we can charge to these programs, which means basically staff to run those programs. And so with this year, with no general fund support, we must address an almost $200,000 shortfall in administrative costs that unfortunately we have to propose a layoff of two staff positions. We don't have any easy decisions for you on this, but we do want to recognize the good work of the staff this year and in past years, all of our staff. And we also want to recognize everyone who has submitted proposals for the grant funds in the coming year, and also the subcommittee members, council members Lutz, Sanchez, and McShane, who made the final review and recommendations on the community services grants. Grace?
Thank you. Well, the purpose of today's meeting is to present the draft action plan to the City Council, setting the stage for the May 8th meeting where the action plan will be adopted. With the exception of consideration of the revised public services funding parameters and also the new ESG funding parameters, which I'll discuss at the very end, there is no formal action necessary at today's meeting. So let's begin with the overall allocations. So new funds for fiscal year 12-13 is about $2.5 million. We have about $888,000 that we're able to reallocate from prior years. And we've estimated program income at about $100,000, providing about $3.574 million to be allocated. And you'll see here the proposed amounts in terms of Actually, I just need to go back one slide. Thank you. Okay, planned use of HUD funds in the categories. I did two columns just so we could have a comparison between the difference from the prior year or current fiscal year to fiscal year 12-13. And then here are the detail on the each category. First with administration and housing services program delivery cost. As Alan already mentioned, CDBG admin costs are limited to 20% of the annual allocation and home at 10%. Budget items include staff, salary, material supplies, training costs, rent, and we also pay a 12% overhead charge to the general fund. In the past, HUD funds had been sufficient to maintain about 8.5 staff members and pay for these other division costs. However, as Alan had already mentioned, due to the significant decline of both CDBG and home, and without the support from city general funds, it's not feasible to maintain all of the current staff. Meanwhile, our regulations are changing, program requirements and scrutiny, not just from HUD, but other regulatory agencies are increasing. In order to meet the existing demands requiring higher level technical expertise, staff recommends restoring the city analyst position from half-time to full-time. And we have identified two new sources from the Housing Trust Fund and also from CDBG and home funds for multifamily, but they are for project-specific delivery cost. In other words, a staff member who works on this, it has to be tied to a specific project and not under administration. So to address the about $180,000 shortfall in administration, we are proposing two positions to be eliminated, office technician and community improvement assistant. These reductions, however, will definitely, you know, test our abilities to be able to carry out the HUD-mandated tasks. The reductions will be partially offset by ramping down of two of our programs, CDBGR and HPRP. Although again, the rest of the regulations are increasing. To further address the workload issue, the Housing Division will relocate to the vacant space in Community and Economic Development offices at 65 West LaSalle, thereby providing shared administrative support with the CED department. Moving on to affordable housing, we received two applications under the this category. The first is for Vista de la Terraza, and it is a it's for site acquisition of the property located at Carr Avenue. We are recommending $350,000. The next item is for Monterey County's Housing Authority Development Corporation's Haciendas Phase 2. This will create 46 units. We're recommending $500,000. The rest of the items there are ongoing activities, including the city first-time homebuyer, some funds for the Housing Resource Center for in assisting with our first-time homebuyer applications, and also our Rebuilding Together and our city rehab and accessibility programs. Under public facilities, we received a total of five applications, four from our Public Works Department. Due to lack of CDBG funds, we are only recommending funding two projects, the East Salinas Streetlights Phase 12 and the ADA Transition Plan. Both have been funded in the prior years, and therefore it is critical for us, in order for us to meet an eligible national objective under HUD rules, that we fund these and that we show them completed in a timely manner. Moving on to public services. Hopefully you guys have a hard copy. It is a little small on here. You'll see a column for a total funding request, then a staff recommendation, and then the subcommittee's recommendation, which was made on March 19th. This year, the committee provided staff direction to allocate CDBG public services using categories, as shown here, and using percentages. In addition, the committee realized that fewer funds means fewer staff resources to implement the program, and therefore have promoted the concept of providing only one grant per category to be implemented beginning in fiscal year 13-14. Still under public service, under ESG, HUD has published the interim rule containing regulations governing the Emergency Solutions Grant Program, which took effect on January 4th of this year. Proposals were received from the five agencies currently supported with city ESG funds. Staff has taken the necessary steps to meet some of the new requirements, including meeting with the area continuum of care to discuss the recommendations that's presented here, and also developing the ESG funding parameters. And you'll see the proposed amounts. If you noticed at the very last, right before the total, City of Salinas Administration, since inception of the ESG program, no funds have been allocated to admin due to its small amount. We usually get about $100,000. And the cap before these new rules were at 5%. They have increased that now to 7.5%. And we also did get additional allocations for both this year and next year. And so the proposed administration cost that I've already presented does include allocating that $14,437 so that we could assist with the admin funding shortfall. Relocation and contingency funds are recommended to cover any cost overruns, any relocation requests within the plan year. Basically, these numbers are whatever else is left after we've done all the other allocations. And then finally, as I mentioned earlier, we're presenting the revised CDBG funding parameters. The Public Services Subcommittee recommended striking the 10% City Council set aside and revised the final category percentages to 67% for youth, 13% for neighborhood services, and also adding cost per participant as a determining factor for funding. and ESG is a new set of funding parameters. With that, I'd just like to thank the entire Housing Division and Alan Stump, Jeff Weir, Don Reynolds, and the rest of the city departments and subcommittees we work with who put this plan together. Each year, we come to council for really two major events, the action plan, which we have today, and the CAPER, which we report our accomplishments. But really behind the scenes, Housing Division has all kinds of hats. We're community advocates, we're grant writers, we're financial planners, we're loan underwriters, residential, commercial, program managers, loan servicers. I mean, I could go on and on. We've even become short sale and foreclosure specialists. So just want to remind staff that, yes, definitely, there's a lot of expertise in this division. So I'd like to ask council to provide direction regarding the proposed allocations and actions, and staff will come back on May 8th for final adoption of the plan. And secondly, consideration of the resolution reflecting the changes to the public services funding parameters as recommended by the subcommittee and also the new ESG funding parameters. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Grace. That was a very good report. I'm going to now ask Councilmember Lutz, she is, I believe, the chair of the committee, to give us a report.
We voted. I just wanted to, as the chair of this committee, first of all, absolutely give our deepest appreciation and thanks to Grace. That was, I know this is really hard and you have to struggle not only with all the applicants, but then with us as we're going through it. So, and to Erica, Ephraim, Alan, everybody that has to deal with us and as we go through struggling and figuring out how do you give so much money when there's this much need. So just really appreciate all that you've done. Couple of things, Council, that we're doing a little bit differently is we divided the recipients into groups, primarily, well, it was four: youth, neighborhood services, senior services, and fair housing. And we divided up the money 67% to youth, because obviously that's our big focus in the city. Neighborhood services 13%, senior services 10%, fair housing 10%. We were trying for several years to say that the minimum amount would be 10,000. We finally gave in and we had to drop it to 8,500 reluctantly, but that's because we've taken such a big cut in, you know, the amount of money we get. So, you know, this is always a very difficult process as we, with dwindling resources and more needs, trying to figure out how to do this as equitably as possible. We've come up with what we think is a fair distribution, and we strongly recommend your support. I understand we're not voting tonight, but we still hope that your comments will be reflective of support for what we've done, and looking to Steve and Sergio if there's anything else that needs to be added.
Just would thank Jill. She's done a great job to keep us moving. And you know, to the colleagues on the council here, we've done our due diligence to do the background. I am in support of, in the 13-14 year, going about that consolidation. I think that will help staff. So that needs to be discussed earlier and sooner as a public services committee. And to the many applicants that have sat through such a meeting, welcome, thank you. I think as it was stated in previous meetings, and I haven't been around as long, this idea of collaboration. So if there's less reporting on the part of staff, by incentivizing nonprofits and community partners to collaborate and come forward, say, on behalf of multiple agencies, multiple nonprofits together for, say, 50,000 or 60,000 as opposed to 8,500 here, 10,000 there, 20,000 there, you're going to hit it out of the park. So I think forewarning, discussion in our Public Services Committee, this might be the only time we see some of the agency heads. So I think it's worthy 1 year in advance plus to begin looking towards that. So that's all I have to say.
Councilmember Sanchez.
Just want to also support that. We've been talking about it for some time, and I think it's time to do that. I think just with less staff and less resources, and less money, I think it just makes sense for people to, and we clustered you guys together already, so hopefully you have a dialogue beyond today's meeting and come forward. One can be the fiscal agent for your category, and then you can distribute the money, but then you can ask us for $50,000, $100,000, then you distribute it amongst yourself and you figure out what's the priority. I think it'll meet more efficiency, it'll more collaboration. It just forces us to be like that, and I think it's a good thing, and it's not a negative, but it makes it easier on staff, and we definitely wanna, I usually don't feel sorry for staff. I say we work hard, they get paid good money, so work hard. But I think it's less people now to manage those many grants, and some of you are very good about reporting your things in time and doing your due diligence. But some of you, they just, you know, you just gotta, we encourage you a whole lot more than we encourage others. So I think that will make it better. So I think it's I support what we have. Not only did we cut some people, but even the city programs have been reduced, and so we cut across, and just one significant one, there was an application that came in very late, and so we did not fund them this year, and that's a city program, and so we did not fund it, just because, you know, you got there's some rules and you follow the rules and you get funded. You don't, then you don't get funded anyway.
Councilmember Lutz.
Thanks, Mayor Pro Tem. I neglected also to thank everybody who has put in applications, the people that have been funded, the groups that have been funded, really have been remarkable, because you've not only had to jump through the hoops that the federal government requires you to jump through, but you've also, I think, worked well with our staff. And we also, your staff is, Grace, has developed kind of an effectiveness scale in terms of how well the money's being spent, and everyone that received money has really been remarkable in terms of how effective you've been spending the money per recipient within your services program. So for that, we really wanted to thank you, because we could see on paper, we could actually see the matrix of how effective you have been in the community. And I think what we realized is without you, we'd be in a lot more hurt than we already are. So thanks to all of you.
Okay, Councilmember Barrera.
In the spirit of support, under the neighborhood services, how did Councilmember Lutz, how did the city of Salinas, under the neighborhood initiative, how did we come up with more money for us than the independent living or the food bank?
She's looking at me. I'm like Mr. Neighborhood. We looked at it actually pretty closely, very closely, and I don't think you can judge it in comparison to one group or another. At the end of the day, it came down to this system this year where there was $2,500 allocated by council district for neighborhoods, three specific areas, and those areas may be tweaked by staff going into the next year. But the fact that it was across the city and incentivizing neighborhood growth, organizations, efforts, associations, watches, and in the case of this year's allocation into next year's, actually the mayor's allocation was decreased, and we thought it would be fair to keep it the same. And in fact, if I can remember specific direction as to how that neighbor or the mayor's money would be used, that it benefit the entire city and not just another district that may already be getting CDBG funds. So kind of the feeding the grassroots. If I may, looking into the future and keeping in mind Grace's comment to try to seek collaboration, I think in the next year, maybe we see neighborhoods as one item, because there is some crossover. There were some excellent proposals brought forward related to the libraries, as the libraries are, you know, kind of a neighborhood resource. So we may see that, but that's ultimately how it was looked at. It wasn't as much as last year, but to keep it at a point where it's not too little of money per council district, so that it's too much administration, that's kind of where we ended there.
And you know, I just have a concern here, being that I know neighborhoods is fantastic, and I think as a council, we're doing a great job interacting with our constituency, bringing them together as one city. Mm-hmm. The Central Coast for Independent Living is just asking for $1,500 more. Food Bank, $3,100. I mean, altogether it's $3,100. With those, what I'm saying, these people have already proven neighborhood. I mean, think about it. Just for $1,500 more, we are providing independence to our folks that are physically, I apologize, I don't want to offend.
Sure.
Physically challenged, but they want to progress. And I think I would like to request to the committee, and I'm supporting you, and I think you've done a lot of work on, all three of you have done a lot of work. But I think they've proven themselves. And for the amount of money, $3,100, where we can take just from our neighborhood initiative, if you would just be willing to give them that money.
If I may respond, I was ready to pull my own wallet out. You read the applications, it tears at your heart how in need several parts to our community are. And we have to be objective. A very helpful tool that Efren developed this year was the cost benefit per participant. If we spend $1, how many people does that impact? And when we judged every piece and every application, this is what we came up with. It was a very long meeting. We brought dinner in. This is our best thinking and our best working with staff. Maybe our chair can speak to that, but I feel very comfortable with what's come forward. I think your comments are good. And in the next year, so that the staff burden's less, if we move towards collaborative, there could be that leveraging. We've got to come up with the best bang for the buck. And when considering the neighborhoods and the number of volunteer hours and the number of people that come forward, there is a lot of ways you can look at that. But that's kind of the discussion that took place.
Okay, thank you.
Councilmember Lutz.
Thank you. My suggestion, Tony, would be that we work with the city manager and Matt Pressy. Neighborhoods are a priority for this council. It certainly has been with our goal setting, and that for this amount of money, it might be something that really should be allocated in our general fund rather than CDBG, given that it would then also guarantee that it not be cut down, because this money is being cut down at all times. But there's certainly nothing wrong with neighborhood services being supported through general fund. And that's something I think when we look at the budget for next year that we could think about. Many, many cities throughout the state, indeed the nation, have neighborhood services as part of their general fund budget. So then that would return all the CDBG money to the nonprofits rather than that. So that would be my suggestion, something that we could think about for next year.
Councilmember McShane.
Yeah, and just to that, Councilwoman Lutz and I were discussing this. I think this is a bigger discussion that this council needs to embrace. I was just talking with our public works director about these types of things, and I know neighborhoods and their many activities add some vitality and some excitement to Sheila Molinari's world and Elizabeth Martinez's world. So as we as a city get our hands around organizations, effort, associations, and to Vanessa Vallarta, some of the potential liabilities when you have somebody with a pickaxe in your park, we just need to get around it. And so I think that's an excellent suggestion. For this year, I think the recommendation should stand, but as we look to 13, 14, collaborations, pooling of the money, and a much larger discussion as to, are we a city of neighborhoods? What is it we're willing to spend and at what expense? Is it part of public safety? Is it not? Is it just a big liability? And do we need a nonprofit to spin off to deal with all of these nosy neighbors? So we can discuss that. That would be my two cents.
Is there any further comment, Councilmember Sanchez?
Well, you know what, I'm going to stop with this one. I see what you're saying, Councilmember McShane, but being that neighborhood services, even though we've provided a service like this, on this initiative, we're sort of like the new kid on the block, if you really look at it. These people have been here for years, and they're serving the community. What I'm saying, $3,100 from our City of Salinas initiative, giving it back to these programs. It's like you say, you can get it out of your wallet or whatever, but I think it's just the service that they've been providing as a neighborhood. I'm done. Thanks.
Anyone else? No? Okay. This is a public hearing, so I'm taking it out to the public for any questions